Not at all.
I'm a physicist. And as a physicist, I like to say that I have two main jobs. The first one of which is to ask questions, and the second one of which is to answer questions. So, thanks to all of you guys, I can say that I'm doing about one half of my job right now. And while I do get asked questions that are often very intimate with what I study personally, I also get asked questions that are a bit more pragmatic. And one such question that really stuck out to me is, can I actually see what you work on? Now, this question makes a lot of sense to me because many physicists work with the theoretical, or at least that is the stigma. But not all stigmas are true, and I've always been much more of a visual learner. I dislike long, wordy explanations when I'd much rather be looking at something. I'd much rather be looking at a figure, looking at a graph. In fact, I think I speak for most of us in this room when I say that I'd much rather be looking at an image. I work with radiation. And what I want for all of you by the end of this talk is to understand how intimate radiation is with seeing. I'm going to take a few moments to show you guys a collection of images. And in these moments, I want you guys to think about what these images are and what they have in common, starting with this first image, the radioactive hazard safety symbol. This is an image I'm sure many of you guys have seen in movies, maybe TV shows, or maybe real life, though I would have some questions. This next image is a radiopharmaceutical. This one right here is carbon-11, and this one is used in positron emission tomography scans. That may sound scary to some of you, but its more common name, PET scan, may ring a few more bells. And for our third image, we have this. Now, what all these images have in common is that they all involve radiation in some form. Yes, even the last one. When I tell people I work with radiation, a lot of times they can quite literally jump back. And since it's my job to ask questions, I like to ask people, okay, what do you think of when I say the word radiation? This could be because of the demographic I asked this question to, but I got some interesting results. The first one of which was nuclear power plants, which, okay, makes perfect, complete sense to me. The second one was Godzilla. And while both of these involve radiation in some form, radiation's actually a lot more common than just these two images. You see, an example of radiation people tend to not think about are rainbows. What you see when perceiving a rainbow is actually electromagnetic radiation. Another example is the warmth we feel from a campfire. We used to think that the fire would heat up the air, and in turn, the air would heat us up. When in reality, it was the warmth from that campfire, the radiation from that campfire, that was making us feel warm the whole time. And then there's also nuclear radiation, which while yes, you do get from your local power plant, you are more likely to get from trace amounts of radioactive potassium isotopes in our food supply. Now this can freak out people. They ask, what food supply is this? Well, this food supply. Fun fact, in the making and the production of this talk, I found out that bananas were considered both a fruit and a berry. This has nothing to do with the rest of this talk. But what I will say is that while you can't choose if a nuclear power plant is built in your backyard, you can choose something else. However, this talk is not about how to avoid radiation. Non-ionizing radiation were some of those examples I listed earlier. The electromagnetic radiation from a rainbow, the warmth we feel from a campfire, and interestingly enough, the radiation that music travels on through AM and FM radio, if any of you guys listen to that still. What I find particularly interesting is ionizing radiation. It's a little bit different from some of those non-ionizing examples from earlier, and how it works is that a buildup of energy occurs. And when that right amount of energy goes on and strikes the atom, an electron is removed from that atom. To ionize just means to remove an electron. An example of ionizing radiation that I think is very familiar to most of us in this room is the X-ray. We are going to segue out of physics and into history for a second. And for the history lovers in your room, you have the time to shine. For the science lovers, this may intrigue you as well as it intrigues me, because it is about the discovery
and the creation of the first ever X-ray. And it all begins with this man right here. It wouldn't be a TED talk if there wasn't a photo of a man way before my time right behind me. This man right here is William Rontgen, and he was a physicist performing experiments on fluorescence utilizing vacuum tubes. Now, this talk is also not about vacuum tubes, but to give you some context, these were tubes that were mostly empty with a little bit of gas in them. And what scientists found particularly intriguing about these tubes was that they would glow when you'd run electricity through them. Now, Rontgen was one of those physicists studying this phenomenon, and he'd cover these tubes when they weren't in use. But then one day he noticed that despite the fact that the tubes were covered, a nearby screen across the room would glow anyway. This fascinated him. We like glowing things as humans. And immediately he began to do some research and began to conclude that there was an invisible ray traveling from the tubes through the covering all the way to the screen. Now, it is not every day that the result of the unknown phenomenon you are studying is actually the result of an invisible ray. And it's not every day where that conclusion would even be considered correct. But nevertheless, Rontgen was correct. And because he didn't know what to name this ray, he decided to name it after what in mathematics is commonly used to signify the unknown, the X-ray. Now, Rontgen knew this X-ray could create images, and he thought to himself that he wanted to create an image intentionally this time. And his wife, Anna Ludwig, gave him her hand. And this was the image created. I show this image for two reasons. The first one of which was that it's the first ever X-ray ever created. That alone is significant, that alone is cool, and we will be getting back to that. But the second reason is that one of the first things ever captured through an X-ray was not just skin, was not just bones, but love, with Anna Ludwig's wedding ring being the most apparent feature of that image. Now, why do I bring this up? I'm not a romantic. It's because that wedding ring absorbed more X-rays than anything else in that field, than the skin, than the bones. And immediately, scientists and physicians and clinicians began to see implications here. It all comes back to physics. And they thought to themselves, if we can see differences between the skin and the bones, what other differences can we see? Can we see differences in different kinds of bones? Maybe we can see fractures, or just maybe we can use it to see things that we know shouldn't be there. In case any of you guys have kids that swallow things or was a kid that swallowed things. But back to my first point. This was the first time ever in human history that we were ever able to see inside the body without cutting it open. Now, I make a promise to all of you. If every time I went to a hospital, I risked being put underneath the knife, I would be extremely hesitant to go to hospitals. And since then, we've progressed. And we don't just take snapshots and images inside the body. We now take videos as well. This is a 4D CT of the lung. Watch it move. However, radiation is not just used for imaging. You see, radiation can also be used for treatment. It can also be used for therapy. Not the kind of therapy that asks about your day at the end of the week, but the kind of therapy involved in the treatment of cancer. Radiation in high doses is lethal, is dangerous. By focusing that radiation and focusing on cancerous cells, we can kill cancerous cells while sparing healthy tissue in the process. It's a balancing act, but it's actually a balancing act that we as humans are quite good at. You see, our cells, our natural human cells, they have these natural checkpoints and safeties against radiation. And that makes sense because we evolved with radiation. It was always there. We like to joke that our whole world is just one big radioactive pool. So naturally, it wouldn't be too harmful. But interesting point, radiation is not just used for treatment and therapy. You see, there are scientists out there that argue that those small doses of radiation aren't just permissible, but that they're actually good for you. To explain this point further, I have a few graphs that have been procured that talk about the risks of radiation measured against amount of radiation. And the first graph I will show you is the linear no threshold model, or is what I'm going to call it for the sake of this talk, the linear model. I'll explain the lack of threshold in a bit. And this model makes one simple assumption. All radiation is bad for you. With the y-axis being risk and the x-axis being amount, what we see is as we get more radiation, we get more risk of radiation, increasing linearly. Linear model. But this brings up an interesting question. What is this threshold or lack of it? And that brings me to the second model, the linear threshold model. You see, scientists from the Radiation Protection Committees and other governmental organizations have come to an interesting conclusion. Small amounts of radiation do not cause harm. That if we were able to find any harm from those small amounts of radiation, we are unable to distinct it currently. And thus, this brings us to our linear threshold model. With the x-axis being once again amount and the y-axis being risk, what we see here is that we have a threshold of radiation you can acquire without receiving any harms. Once that threshold is passed, we once again receive the harms of radiation linearly. Linear threshold model. Good news, you are now all one step closer to becoming physicists. But there is a third model, the radiation hormesis model. Hormesis is an idea that doesn't just exist in the concept of radiation. You see, hormesis is an idea that a little bit of a bad thing can actually be good for you. This may sound like an adage your father has told you at one point or another, but in reality, there's a scientific backing. And the scientific backing that scientists like to throw out is the example of vitamins. You see, small amounts of vitamins are good for you, are healthy, and is relatively needed by your body. Too many vitamins in excess, is poisonous. Scientists argue that radiation could work that same way. Small amounts of radiation can be good for you, can provide some health benefits. Too much radiation in excess, brings us back to lethality. So with the hormesis model, we have a sweet spot. A sweet spot of radiation you can get where you get health benefits from it. Going past that sweet spot, you get diminishing returns. Further past that sweet spot, harms. Now, I'm going to take a moment to state the obvious here. These last two models with scientific backing contradict each other. And bad news for everyone, the jury is still out trying to deliberate which model is correct, or should I say more correct, more preferred. But there is some room for optimism here. Perhaps worst case scenario, small amounts of radiation are indeed permissible. Best case scenario, maybe you should try getting it on your day to day. But this isn't what people think about when I say the word radiation. And I know this isn't what people think about because when I asked them, I got Godzilla. I didn't get hospital procedures. I didn't get wedding bands being imaged, and I certainly did not get the word hormesis, though I'd be quite impressed if anyone did. Instead, I get different things. I get disastrous-like conditions. I get apocalypse, or more generally, I get that radiation is just something negative, that it isn't a tool for humanity to use. And with that, I strongly disagree. Now, not everyone is a scientist, not everyone needs to conduct their own research, though I highly wish everyone did, but there are stigmas, and these stigmas play into people's decisions involving their health. The facts on radiation refusal. First, patients were twice as likely to deny radiation as a form of treatment as opposed to surgery, despite it being recommended by their physician. Two, Black Americans were 30% more likely to deny radiation as a form of treatment as opposed to their white counterparts. And three, studies have concluded that patients who deny radiation as treatment place a great deal of emphasis on understanding that treatment. Well, for the last one, go figure. People want to know what's going on when going through something as unknown as hospital visits and cancer. People cite fears, ranging from becoming radioactive to becoming infertile. And these are rational fears to have. I think it's extremely important to have these conversations, to talk about where we went wrong, because we have went wrong, where we went right, how we improved, and how we're continuing to improve. The stigma is dangerous. The stigma is deadly. There are people denying the best treatments for their health, for their cancer, because of that stigma. And stigmas get broken down through people like all of you being willing to listen to a new perspective that perhaps may have been unheard of before. All that being said, I don't want you guys to take the message as to preach a certain way. I don't want you guys to go home to preach the hormesis model to your friends and family, nor do I wish for you guys to preach any model for your friends and family. And I certainly don't think that all of us should walk around with a potentially radioactive substance in our pocket for the sake of hormesis. I, however, do think it makes a great paperweight. Thank you all so much.